great event.
What happened, some of us got hijacked by the Black Lives Matter movement.
Yeah.
So that went by the wayside.
Yeah. Well, we can talk about it in a second. Yes. But since this talk is rather long,
okay,
may as well get started. But those of you who don't know, I'm Doug Green, or Doug Enaa Greene. I'm a Marxist historian, a volunteer here at the CME, and the author of a book on Louis Auguste Blanqui, which will hopefully be out next year from Haymarket Books. And I also give a monthly lecture series on theorists, events, movements that try to stay out of the 3, 4, or 5 heads. So last month was Gramsci, we're doing the Greek Civil War, and I'll just give you the rundown for the rest of the year, which will be next month will be Harry Braverman, who would actually be the first U.S. Marxist I've bothered to do, which, and then after that, Jose Carlos Marietegui, Nikos Palantzis in November, and Daniel Bencied in December. If you're wondering about 2016, I have no clue, so you'll just have to wait on that. Obviously, this hopefully is rather timely, since I suspect most of you follow the news and have been following events in Greece, so this is more meant to be historical background. I considered rewriting it to add allusions to contemporary events, but I decided not to because it's already too long. So if you make any allusions, probably should. And if you're interested, tomorrow the film night will be Costa Gravis' movie City, which deals with political assassination in Greece in the 1960s. It's a wonderful film. And this is essentially background to the political situation preceding that. And again, this talk is long, and unfortunately it's as long as it has to be, because I suspect a lot of you don't know a lot of the details beyond the Civil War occurred, and the wrong side won. I also apologize, I can't pronounce Greek names at all. I can spell them actually at this point, but I can't pronounce them, so I'm very sorry. But anyway, let's get started. So this talk is Struggle and Suffering, the Greek Civil War. And so we'll start on March 24th, 1945, when the famed partisan leader, Arius Velutius, wrote the following letter in a letter to the Central Committee of the Greek Communist Party, KKE, for those of you who don't know. Why did you do this? Where are we going? Why did we shed so much blood? Why did they burn our houses for 3 years? Why are you handing us over without a battle? What are we going to do now? Where is our popular justice, our self-government? Reaction has raised its head. You don't see any of this. You've been isolated from the popular masses, and you've lost their pulse. Wake up. Even at this late stage, it's not too late, but soon it will be, and we'll then need massive sacrifices in blood and toil. Don't let reaction permanently gain a foothold. Velutius was writing in protest to what he perceived as the sellout of the Treaty of Vrakizia that was signed by the KKE only a month previously. Although the Greek communists had led the resistance to the Nazis and liberated the bulk of the country, they had agreed to demobilize their armed units, accept amnesty, and hold a referendum on the monarchy. The treaty was a political disaster for the KKE, leaving their supporters defenseless before wanton white terror at the hands of security battalions who were actually just Nazi collaborators. Among the fallen was Velutius, who took up arms again rather than surrender. In 1946, the KKE leadership had little choice but to resort to armed struggle, beginning 3 years of civil war, which saw the ultimate defeat of the communists, tens of thousands of deaths, and the installation of an authoritarian right-wing regime. The roots of the Greek Civil War can be traced back to pre-war society, with its monarchy, class inequalities, and being at the mercy of imperialist powers such as Great Britain and later the United States. During the Second World War, the old order collapsed and resistance was taken up by the Greek Communist Party. Their support was fueled not only by a popular desire to resist the invaders, but for social transformation. Both Britain and the monarchy were determined to restore the antebellum situation by any means necessary. Despite the overwhelming support for the Greek communists, they did not seize power upon the liberation in October 1944. And soon found themselves confronting not only the king, but the British army. The loss by the communists can be traced back to a number of factors: poor political decisions, indecisiveness in recognizing their enemies, failure to take the initiative, military mistakes during the Civil War, and the fact that they were decisively outgunned by the United States, who aided the Royalists. So let's start with Greek society. Following 500 years of Ottoman rule by the Ottoman Empire, the Greeks achieved independence in 1830 after a long war. However, the new Greek state had a foreign monarchy imposed upon it by the great powers as a concession for independence, and in order to ensure that the country adhered to the Holy Alliance, the old regime in Europe that had followed the French Revolution. The monarchy was not accepted by all in Greece, though. Many wished to curtail or abolish what they saw as alien rule. The politics of the newly independent Greece were linked with those of France, Britain, and Russia, with political parties bearing the names of their foreign patrons. By the mid-20th century, Britain had eased out its rivals to become the dominant power in Greece and the Mediterranean. Furthermore, Greece was a small and backward country. The power of the state was confined mainly to the cities and towns. By contrast, the countryside and the mountains were generally isolated from the government. In the mountains, there were bandits, some of whom had played major roles in the struggle for independence, but it subsequently went back to their former roles and obeyed their own laws, though sometimes they're utilized by different factions. And according to one historian, in the 20th century, these isolated communities would become hostage to guerrilla armies and serve as staging areas and battlegrounds of insurgencies opposed to foreign occupation and the political order in the capital. Despite these flare-ups of resistance, in order for a new government to be successful and legitimate, it had to establish itself in the capital of Athens. The small size of the country fueled irredentist claims to recover lost territory from the Ottoman Empire and Turkey, or later Turkey. These nationalist yearnings led to Greece's involvement in two Balkan wars in the 1912 and 1913, World War I, and a disastrous war with Turkey in 1922. And from 1924 through 35, Greece established its first republic, was unstable and had to fend off several coups, and a humanitarian crisis in dealing with more than a million refugees from Turkey. Each military coup led to purges within the army, with initially royalists removed, but subsequent purges led to the creation of a largely non-republican army by 1940. Political instability was compounded by the Depression, which brought widespread unemployment and unrest, which led to the reestablishment of the monarchy in a fraudulent plebiscite in 1935. The monarchy of George II was supported heavily by the military, who feared possible communist inclusion in a coalition government of that year, since the KKE had 15 deputies who held the balance of power in parliament. The liberals were entering into secret talks with the communists, which leaked out. As a result, no government was formed. At the same time, there was labor unrest in the city of Thessaloniki by tobacco, railway, and tram workers, and a strike, which initially numbered 6,000, grew to 25,000, even as the army was brought in, who massacred 12 people and wounded up to 200. As a result of strikes and the lack of a stable government, the king gave power to General Metaxas, who in 1936 established martial law and an authoritarian dictatorship. The dictatorship was, of course, supported by landlords, merchants, and the crown, and which brazenly emulated the fascist regimes of Italy and Germany. And the regime sought to squelch any opposition, seeing their main opponent correctly as the Communist Party. And the Greek Communist Party was formed in November of 1918, and it was really a small party cut off from the mainstream, and it was hostile to ultra-nationalist claims and radical, and it was also marginalized due to its radical politics. By 1922, it possessed only 1,500 members. In these early years, the party was racked by various ideological and political conflicts, and it was primarily concentrated among the working class in Athens, Piraeus, and Thessaloniki. Following the war with Turkey, the refugees from Asia provided the KKE with a social base, and prominent leaders such as Nikos Zakharidis. Zakharidis was an Orthodox Party member, spending time in the Soviet Union in the 20s, becoming General Secretary in 1934, and holding that position until he died in 1952. He was elected to Parliament shortly before the Metaxas coup and imprisoned from 1936 through 1942. And when the Italians invaded Greece in 1940, he demanded that party members fight alongside the forces of Metaxas. No doubt this must have been a bitter pill to swallow for those imprisoned and tortured. And in 1942, he was transferred to a concentration camp in Germany in Dachau, and he was freed in 1945. Yet as we see, he did not possess the qualities needed to lead the Greek Revolution. By 1929, the KKE numbered only about 3,000 members, who could expect arrest and imprisonment at the hands of the government. Among the members of the KKE was Thanius Clarius, or Ares Volutius, which is how he's mostly known as, who was born in 1905 to a liberal bourgeois family. He has studied agronomy, and he eventually became involved with the revolutionary left when he joined the army. And he was actually imprisoned by the army in 1925 for being rebellious, and by 1929 he was leader of the youth wing of the Communist Party, spending time in jail for 45 days. And the following year he was he wound up being imprisoned several times, eventually exiled to an island south of Crete where many prisoners succumbed to malaria. And while there, he actually took charge of his inmates and built a common settlement and kept a strict exercise regime. Yet even after his release from exile in 1932, was only a prelude to four more years of prison. However, the repression of the Metaxas regime was at a qualitatively different level than anything that had come before. Communists were now being actively hunted, imprisoned, and tortured. Among the tortures inflicted, according to a historian, was they were made to sit on blocks of ice while force-fed castor oil. The victims suffered horribly from uncontrollable diarrhea, but the object of torture was to strip them of any semblance of dignity. The security forces also coerced thousands of real or suspected communists to sign declarations of repentance in order to avoid prison or to be released. And in fact, they had actually claimed in 1940 that they had signed 57,000 declarations, even though the Communist Party numbered at most 14,000 members. And this was, of course, would include sympathizers or just people caught up. And those party members who remained free had to operate, of course, clandestinely, and a skill that would actually serve them very well during the Second World War. Arius himself was imprisoned again in 1939. He signed one of these declarations in order to regain his freedom. And although some communists were ordered to sign such declarations to carry out party work on the outside, the effect would still be demoralizing and humiliating. And most of those who signed the declarations had, in fact, been broken under torture. The Metaxas dictatorship publicized these declarations in order to poison KKK organizations with suspicion, both real and imagined, that the repenters were actually police and provocators. We don't know if Zacharias had ordered Arius to repent, but the shadow of that signature would hung over the future partisan for the remainder of his life. And even though the government nearly managed to wipe out the KKE, the period of repression actually hardened its cadre, and during World War II, the party would grow from a persecuted minority to an armed force of hundreds of thousands, carrying the hopes of the masses for national liberation and social change. And even though the Metaxas regime was quasi-fascist, Greece was actually allied with Great Britain and France. And even despite this, Metaxas wanted to keep Greece out of the war, which meant he played a delicate balancing act between the British and the Axis. Mussolini, though, was eager to expand his Italian power in the Mediterranean. Greece was plunged into the war when they rejected an Italian ultimatum that would have reduced them to a satellite. So on October 28th, of 1940, the Italians invaded Greece from their colony in neighboring Albania. The invasion was an unmitigated disaster for Mussolini, pretty much like most of Italian involvement in World War II. The Italian army had to fight on mountainous terrain and poor weather, which was exacerbated by logistical problems, and they were soon overextended. And to give you an idea of how badly they performed in their invasion, by January of 1941, Greece had not only pushed the Italians out of Greece, but they conquered one quarter of Albania. The Germans had not supported the Italian invasion of Greece since they did not have faith in the ability, correctly, in the ability of fascist arms in Italy. Yet Hitler intervened because he feared that the Greek debacle would open southeastern Europe to the British, then stationed in their colony of Egypt. So 58,000 British and Commonwealth troops went to Greece, but it was a very small force that lacked both tanks and aircraft. So Hitler decided to rescue Mussolini and protect his southern flank in preparation for the forthcoming invasion of the Soviet Union. So on April 6th of 1941, the Wehrmacht launched a blitzkrieg against both Yugoslavia and Greece. And even though the British actually had accurate intelligence about German troop movements, they remained too weak to effectively resist. The Greek army was out of position. And so within a few weeks, by April 27th, Greek and Allied forces were overwhelmed. Athens was captured. Greek and British forces evacuated to Crete, which was the Germans attacked on May 20th of that year in history's first airborne invasion. But by June 1st, Crete too was conquered, despite heavy costs to the Germans. Greece was primarily under Italian and Bulgarian occupation, being one of the Axis allies, although the Germans controlled strategically important areas such as Athens. The Germans set up a puppet government that was not only ineffective, but increasingly brutal and unpopular. I'm surprised. The Greek monarchy and the remnants of the army fled to Cairo to set up a government in exile under British protection. the German occupation came after the end of more than 6 months of war to an exhausted people. Although the Germans had made some efforts to soften their approach, this had little effect. The Germans had come to Greece as conquerors. Their soldiers were parading in the streets, and they requisitioned the personal possessions of ordinary people. The Germans also purchased goods in currency that lost its value. Greece was subjected to ruthless economic exploitation as food and raw materials were taken to serve the German war machine. In light of plunder by the Axis powers and the economic and infrastructural disruptions of the occupation, Greece was overcome by famine in 1941-42. Even in peacetime, Greece had depended on imports of food to feed its people, but the war had cut off normal sources of trade, such as with Britain. And the famine bred hatred for the Germans and encouraged the creation of mass resistance. And it affected heavily the urban areas, and ultimately about 100,000 people would die. Actually, just in Athens, 100,000 people died. Ultimately, 250,000 Greeks died in a population that totaled 7 million just during the famine. It is important to note that the famine fell hardest again on the urban sector, since the countryside was largely isolated, self-contained, but they actually possessed a surplus of food. So the villagers spent a great deal of that surplus to the cities. This implied a fundamental shift in the balance of power within Greece, as the centralized power in the state radiated from the city to the villages. And because the famine and the guerrilla forces of the mountains, the roles reversed, the legitimate Greek political authority shifted to the village. And the first acts of resistance to the Germans were disorganized and uncoordinated. The resistance began with symbolic acts, such as students taking down the swastika from the Acropolis in Athens and raising the Greek flag. And leaving aside talk of the role of guerrillas until later, it's important to note that the urban working class in Greece played a major role in the resistance. There were working class demonstrations in Athens to mark the first anniversary of the Italian invasion in October 1941, student demonstrations in December, major strikes in 1942, and Greece had probably a much more extensive working class than working class resistance than a lot of occupied Europe, maybe excepting Italy or Yugoslavia. And as a result of actions of the resistance, Greece wound up sending no foreign laborers to Germany. Yet the Germans extracted bloody reprisals and launched at least 9 major operations against the guerrillas, mainly in northern Greece. And as the war dragged on elsewhere, Germany faced the combined might of the Soviet Union, Britain, and the United States, which strained their resources. Following the surrender of Italy in 1943, the Germans supported the efforts of the collaborationist Greek government to establish security battalions to replace Italian troops, and the efforts of the communist-led guerrillas drove many conservative officers to enlist in the security battalions. The battalions were commanded by German forces and began with an oath which read, unambiguously, "I swear by God, the sacred oath, that I will obey absolutely the orders of the supreme commander of the German army, Adolf Hitler." However, the extreme anti-communism of the security battalions and fears of a leftist takeover meant that the Greek government in exile and the British were unwilling to denounce them. Winston Churchill, Prime Minister of Britain, privately said, "It seems to me that the collaborators in Greece, in many cases, did the best they could to shelter the Greek population from German oppression." Only in September 1944, mere weeks before the Germans withdraw, did the monarchy condemn the security battalions as traitors, and even that was temporary. On October 12, 1944, the Red Army was advancing through Eastern Europe. The Germans began their withdrawal from Greece, and 6 days later, British forces and the government in exile landed in Athens, where a struggle for power with the communists began almost immediately. And the German occupation had devastated Greece, and just some facts, it cost the lives of 8% of the population, approximately 550,000 people, 34% of its national wealth, 402,000 houses, 1,770 villages destroyed, leaving 1.2 million people homeless. Furthermore, 56% of the roads, 65% of private cars, 60% of trucks, and 80% of buses were out of action. And the ordeal, of course, was far from over. Now let's go to the resistance. Following the death of Metaxas in January of 1941, the new government in exile was controlled by the king. However, the government had no outstanding personalities in it, nor any legitimacy. While George II distanced himself from the discredited dictatorship, he's not willing to contemplate any major constitutional or social changes. He saw his first and only priority as winning the war. Ultimately, the monarchy had only tenuous connections to the mainland, which meant they lost the initiative in organizing a resistance force. And despite these weaknesses, the British remained firm supporters of the monarchy. British policies, though, toward various resistance movements remained adaptable enough, despite their misgivings, to provide aid to non-royalist forces. And despite their flexibility, the British remained determined to restore the pre-war regime to Greece, no matter what it took. The power vacuum in occupied Greece was filled by a number of resistance organizations of differing social and political origins. And in Greece, just like Albania, Yugoslavia, Italy, and France, the largest component of the anti-fascist resistance was formed and led by the communists, which goes to show you how much crap theories of totalitarianism are. On September 27, 1941, the National Liberation Front, or the EAM, was formed at the initiative of the communists with support from other parties. And the KKE Central Committee, who formed the EAM, were aided by their years of clandestine work and the fact that they had actually not been infiltrated. And the National Liberation Front was not formed on a strictly communist platform. It was conceived as a broad front to unite for national liberation. This approach allowed the EAM to grow rapidly. And joining the front did not require any particular sacrifice. One only to accept the organization as a common resistance front. And under these terms, they acquired thousands and ultimately hundreds of thousands of members who, by the simple act of becoming members, could believe themselves to be fighting the occupation authorities. Now, the EAM was not an army, but a political organization that sought to create a resistance state which operated right under the noses of the Nazis. The front soon possessed a network that spread across the countryside into the cities, encompassing workers, peasants, students, and women. And the front created a parallel state with organs of self-government in villages and even holding an election involving 1 million Greeks under Nazi occupation in March of 1944. The front sponsored election wound up creating the Political Committee of National Liberation, the PEEA, a new provisional government that possessed 250 delegates from all social classes. And their program for a liberated Greece included planks promising social changes and self-determination. In light of the lack of credibility that the monarchy possessed, the front could now lay claim to being the sovereign power in Greece. At its height, the front could count on the support of at least 1 to 2 million Greeks. Now, while the front was the political wing of the resistance movement, it also possessed a military wing known as the Greek Army of National Liberation, or LS. In June 1942, in the village of Dominista, 300 kilometers northeast of Athens, Arius gave a speech where he proclaimed, "Patriots, I am Arius Volutius, colonel of artillery. Starting today, I am raising the banner of revolt against the forces occupying our beloved country. The handful of men you see before you will soon become an army of thousands. We are just a nucleus." And it was a grand boast, but he was proven correct. Starting with only 15 members, LS grew to 5,000 combatants by the spring of 1943. 5 months later, they numbered 40,000. And it's important to note that LS received very little outside aid. LS managed to expand rapidly under Arius' command, conducting guerrilla war against the Nazis in the mountainous regions. And in March of 1943, they expanded their operations into Peloponnesus, which is in southern Greece, and into central and northern Greece, with the result that many of these areas fell under their control. The resistance movement led by LS vastly transformed the situation of women as well. Traditionally, women in Greece were illiterate and treated as cattle. They mobilized women, who formed their own battalions, created schools, and gave them suffrage in the liberated zones. The provisional government granted them equal political and civil rights, and women deputies in the new government were also granted equal pay. LS also benefited from the popular support and network set up by the National Liberation Front in the villages and towns. They recruited a considerable number of military officers who were attracted to their success. LS also was aided by the fact that the acronym for the organization pronounced actually means Greece, LS, which served as a powerful piece of propaganda. Furthermore, LS built upon the popular legends of bandits and outlaws in the countryside, since the guerrilla commanders themselves, or capitanos, were leaders who supported the aspirations of the masses. The capitanos were viewed by both the British and the KKE leadership as uncontrollable, violent, and social radicals. The capitanos were determined to push for the military advantage of LS and their own vision of a liberated Greece, regardless of what any of their allies or their enemies thought. The Capitanos were hampered politically, though, since they had very little influence within the KKE leadership, who opposed not just their radicalism and ill-discipline, but their unorthodox strategy of rural warfare as opposed to urban insurrection. Arias himself was both feared and admired as a commander. His legend spread throughout Greece in song, rumor, and newspaper. He was a leader in the operation that destroyed a viaduct in November of 1942. They cut the main railroad lines from Athens to Thessaloniki that seriously disrupted German troop movements. Arias was not only a charismatic figure, but had the reputation for brutality, since he executed not only traitors, but thieves and rapists. He made a number of enemies, including those of rival guerrilla groups, the British who feared him, and the KKE. The KKE at one point even recalled him to Athens in 1943, where he was reprimanded for his methods of terror and for endangering the chances of British recognition of LS. Although Arias managed to reassure his detractors, this was not his last confrontation with the Communist Party. The KKE had grown enormously during the war to at least 350,000 members by 1945. Although the party proved the leading core of the resistance movement, it did not manipulate it like a puppet on strings. The KKE had actually managed to build a genuinely broad movement for social and national liberation that extended far, far beyond its ranks. Yet the Communist Party determined that struggling Greece was to be confined to the task of national liberation, would not only step its bounds to social revolution. The leaders of the party believed that the social aspirations needed to take a back seat in light of the war in order to build a broad popular front of all classes and secure British aid. While the party followed Comintern directives, which had been disbanded in 1943, to build a national front to fight the Nazis, it should be noted that those communications were disrupted during the war. If the Communist Party had wanted to, they could have pursued a far different policy, but the leadership remained committed to national tasks and was not going to make a bid for power. Although the party expanded its membership during the resistance, this did not translate into changes in the party line. Not a single man who joined the party from the resistance was admitted into the top echelons of leadership. So unlike, say, Yugoslavia, Albania, or China, where the parties were willing to translate their armed strength into a bid for political power, no such impetus could be found within the Communist Party of Greece, since the leadership sought to limit expressions of radicalism. This meant that radical capitanos such as Arias, while they were popular, were isolated within the Communist Party. And while the Communist Party remained committed to the struggle, national struggle, the British and the government in exile did not believe them and were willing to prepare for a showdown to determine who ruled Greece. Now, LS may have been the largest anti-Nazi resistance movement, but they were not the only one. Another one was formed in 1941. A group of purge Republican officers formed the National Greek Democratic League. And the League was pledged to prevent the return of the monarchy, to purge the army of monarchists, and to implement social and political and other changes. And the main leader was a Republican officer, gambler, and a womanizer named Napoleos Darvius. And despite his Republican credentials, the League had very limited support and was mostly based near Athens. This meant that they expanded far more slowly than LS, even though they possessed actually better trained officers and partisans. And by March of 1943, they only actually had 4,000 guerrillas. A number of the factors actually limited their support. For one, the leadership was not willing to mobilize the people, something that LS believed was essential to fighting the Nazis. Secondly, and despite their republicanism, both the British and the Greek monarchy courted them as a non-radical alternative to the communists. To this end, the League was furnished with supplies by the British, and by March of 9th of 1943, the League pledged, on behalf of the League, pledged his loyalty to the king. By embracing a discredited monarchy, the League ensured that the earnings for radical social change would be channeled through LS. And thirdly, LS was able to out-organize the League, absorbing other units by their ability not only to organize the people, but effectively fight the Germans. And this was definitively proven by the fact that LS suffered more than four-fifths of resistance casualties during the war. Even though LS and the League were at war with the Nazis, relations between the two were uneasy. At one point, defectors from LS went into League territory, and Arias led soldiers to capture and punish them. And this actually almost brought out armed clashes, but British agents on the scene managed to cool things down. There were talks between Zervius and Arias to unite their forces, but the talks fell through. since the League actually wanted overall command of the resistance, slipping their size would not warrant. Yet the British did not give up their efforts to unify the two groups. Not only was the Communist Party eager for British recognition and support, but the British needed them to win the war. The two groups nominally agreed to cooperate and accept overall British command of the resistance in 1943, despite in practice there was still mistrust and armed fighting between the two resistance groups. Ultimately, in 1944, two treaties were signed in Lebanon and Castria between Elas, the League, the monarchy that established the Greek government of national unity. The treaties denounced communist terrorism, left open the question of the monarchy, and set up a single command. As part of the treaties, and this is important, is agreed to disband the security battalions. And despite these concessions, the British and the Crown also secured communist support for dealing with the problem of security after the liberation, which effectively gave the British and the Greek governments control of key areas, thus enabling them to offset some of the strategic advantage held by the LS. And again, the British were already preparing for the post-war. There have been forebodings of civil war, even as World War II is still being fought. Not only was the communists fighting the League, but the Greek army was showing that it was potentially mutinous. Greek soldiers in exile, who numbered about 20,000, were determined to fight, but they had different goals from the Royalist officer corps. They were anti-fascist, and they hated the monarchy, and they wanted an end to foreign domination in Greece. And these differences between the ranks and their commanders led to two mutinies within the Greek army. The first in October of 1941, when soldiers who had formed an underground organization, they demanded to be sent to Greece to fight. Officers sympathetic to the dictatorship purge and their own, officers not to be discharged. The government caved, but it really didn't lead to any substantial changes. And this led to a much more extensive mutiny a few years later in March and April of 1944 with the underground anti-fascist organization, which remained intact, collected a petition by the majority of Greek soldiers that supported a national government of unity based on the communist platform. And was actually presented to the Soviet embassy in Cairo, who actually refused to receive them, and the Greek government exiled. The movement was not led or organized by any left-wing resistance forces in Greece, though, but is organized and spontaneously from the soldiers themselves. The mutiny led to mass demonstrations in Cairo and Alexandria that was supported actually by Egyptian workers and spread to the Navy. But the British moved in quickly, disarming unreliable units, anti-fascist ones, and arresting the ringleaders. And by mid-April, the mutiny was put down, and the Greek army of the Middle East no longer existed, and 20,000 soldiers were now languishing in concentration camps. And the army was reorganized with well-armed units loyal to the crown who were imbued with virulent anti-communism. And again, the British did not want any changes in the monarchy in Greece. Yet they had to face the realities of war, where it was the communists who were leading the bulk of the resistance and mobilizing the people. To this end, they played the carrot of offering concessions to the communists that left the old order fundamentally intact, but also used the stick by supporting ineffective anti-communist resistance forces and putting down mutinies in the Greek army. So Britain was faced not only with fighting a war, but with a brewing revolution. In summing up the vast social changes that occurred in Greece and other occupied countries during World War II, Basil Davidson, a member of the British Special Operations Executive, who's himself acted in Yugoslavia and Italy, makes the following conclusion, which is worth quoting in full. In Greece and Yugoslavia, and to a varying degree in all occupied countries, large and serious resistance came and could only come under left-wing leadership and inspiration. Whole ruling classes had collapsed in defeat or moved into compromise with the Nazis. With notable exceptions, the beaten generals followed their governments and kings in exile, went into retirement, or took service with the Nazi occupiers. Some believed they could conciliate the conquerors, others despaired of any rescue, not if you shared the beliefs and aims of the Nazis. Preaching the unification of a Nazified Europe, Hitler was able to win fighting volunteers from every occupied country. Again, with exceptions, the right wing sold out and the center simply vanished from the scene. Here and there, patriotic officers tried to stand against this collapse and call for resistance in the name of king and conservatism. Yet the people whom they call prove reluctant or quite unwilling to follow them. Plenty of ordinary folk were ready to risk their lives, but only, as it soon transpired, they're not risking them for king and conservatism. In these countries of bitter pre-war dictatorship, it further transpired the self-sacrifice and vision required to begin an effective resistance and then rally others to the same cause. profound only among radicals and revolutions. Exceptions there were, but such was the general rule. And again, in practice, this leadership was found above all among the men and women of harried and clandestine communist parties whose remnants were still unbowed by persecution. Now, many LS members could be forgiven for believing that the Red Army, then sweeping the Wehrmacht before it would move into Greece and ensure the liberation of their country. However, the Soviet Union was not willing to jeopardize its wartime alliance by encouraging communist parties to take power. In fact, as it became clear that Germany was going to be defeated, the Allies were already negotiating on the post-war division of Europe. So in October of 1944, as the Germans were withdrawing from Greece, Churchill arrived in Moscow for meeting with Stalin on Allied spheres of influence in Eastern Europe. From this comes the famous percentage agreement dividing Eastern Europe in various ways. Russian predominance recognized in Romania, Hungary and Yugoslavia evenly divided, and Bulgaria with 70% to the Russians. And actually, in this agreement, Greece overwhelmingly fell under British influence. However, in a number of countries, the percentage agreement was actually quite meaningless, since the Red Army would actually just sweep, was just going to move in there anyway. But however, by agreeing that the British were going to have the paramount influence in Greece, Stalin ensured that he would not encourage any uprising by the Greek communists, nor move the Red Army in. It was not if the Soviets were unaware that the British would put down a potential Greek uprising. And as part of the October occurred, both sides agreed confidentially that if the British found it necessary to take military action to quell disorders, the Soviets would not intervene. And in return, the British would recognize the right of the Soviets to maintain order in their sphere. Stalin could have probably had no doubt what these internal disorders were. And the Soviets were true to their word. When fighting broke out in Athens, they raised no objections. Nor did the Soviet Union have anything to really say when the United States intervened in Greece as part of the Civil War. However, in assessing Stalin's responsibilities for what occurred in Greece, the Greek Maoist Kostas Mavrakis says that the Soviet government agreement with the British did not mean that Stalin undertook to press the Greek communists not to oppose the British intervention. Even the most extreme advocates of this thesis under discussion do not go that far. He also says that Stalin did not want to risk another war while the Red Army was still fighting. And the second point is only political realism, which is certainly understandable. Yet in regards to the first point, the Soviet envoys did not warn the Greek communists to be prepared for battle. And as Mavrakis says, it was Stalin's duty to urge the communist leaders to prepare themselves and the masses to resist the return of reaction, since those leaders were incapable of understanding this by themselves. His silence may be explained by the same error. He lacked popular masses and allowed himself to be intimidated by the apparent power of British imperialism. Stalin no longer believed the Greek people could win against a formidable enemy. He did not want to urge them on a hopeless struggle. While Stalin and the Soviet Union certainly do bear responsibility for pushing the Greek Communist Party to subordinate their aspirations and participate in the pro-British government, ultimately it was not the task of either Stalin or the Soviet Union to make a revolution in Greece. The Communist Party themselves could just as easily ignore that advice and decide to strike out on their own, something that Mao and Tito would do. The communist leadership was quite willing, even when they had little contact with the Soviet Union, to limit their aims in the interests of the alliance and feared a challenge for power. Ultimately, the main responsibility for the failure to take the offensive lies in the leadership of the Communist Party of Greece, who had the forces on the ground and did not press their advantage. So this brings us to October of 1944, when Greece was liberated as the Germans withdrew, and the British moved into the capital, followed a few days later by the government in exile. And this new government had the task of creating a new army and restoring order. But they only actually possessed a navy, a small air force, and a single brigade. And following the mutinies in Egypt, these forces were staffed with conservative and royalist officers. Yet LS and their supporters were not going to support an army that they believed was tied to the pre-war dictatorship. Whereas the crown controlled Athens, LS ruled almost the entire country and could easily have moved into the capital and proclaimed themselves the new power. But in line with previous agreements, they did not take over. And upon liberation, most members of the security battalions were imprisoned. Yet the Greeks and British had decided to reinstate quietly at least the officers who served in the battalions. At the same time, it became British policy to dissolve the front and dismantle allies while using collaborators to support the Greek government. So soon, members of the battalions were released or allowed to escape, and within a short time afterward, they were again wearing Greek army uniforms. Naturally, allies were outraged, provoking a crisis inside the government, yet the Crown and the British needed them to disarm allies. The crisis culminated in December of 1944 when the government presented an ultimatum to allies to disarm its organization and dissolve, and this was a deliberate provocation that set the stage for civil war. Throughout, the KKE remained committed to cooperation with the British and the Crown, yet Arius did not trust the British and believed that a confrontation was imminent. In November, he had actually held a meeting to discuss the situation with the Central Committee, but they were not willing to consider fighting the British, which left Arius isolated and alone. The end result of a party that remained bound by old formulas and not willing to seize the this was the end result of a party that was bound by old formulas and was not willing to seize the opportunities that presented themselves. The communists would find themselves caught off guard in December. The hopeless situation of Arius also showed that the Capitanos, despite their popularity and military prowess, had no organization comparable to that of the Communist Party. Yet the front was not willing to bow to the orders of the government and disarm, and their representatives walked out a day later, December 2nd. The following day, there was a general strike, and Elas was reorganized. The demonstrators, who numbered 200,000, marched through Centagina Square, where they were confronted by British tanks and Greek police. Tensions were high, and it did not take much for shots to be fired. We don't know who actually fired the first shot, but the police responded by shooting at demonstrators, and at least 28 were killed in the massacre, which started several weeks of fighting in Athens. And the Greek government still only possessed a few forces at their command, meaning they relied on the British, who used their troops, artillery, and aircraft to deal with protesters. And after the first day of fighting, the demonstrators again returned to the streets, now flanked by armed LS militants who fired back. And LS cadre targeted the police, whom the left identified with the occupation. And during the fighting, there was actually reports of torture and executions by LS. At one point during the December fighting, LS used their own political police to massacre anarchists and Trotskyists in Athens. And by the 12th of December, LS was in control of most of Athens, and the British considered moving out. However, LS had largely concentrated their fire on the Greek police and army, leaving the British alone, since they did not want to escalate the conflict. Even now, they still wanted to reopen negotiations as people were being gunned down. And in a major miscalculation, LS units throughout the rest of Greece did not engage the British or to expel them from the country. These errors allowed the British to bring in reinforcements who held key facilities and were able to regain control of southern Athens. Churchill had been quite adamant in its orders to the commander of British forces stationed in Athens, "Do not hesitate to act as you are in a conquered city where a local rebellion is in progress." This was, of course, only a natural response by Churchill, who had a history of suppressing anti-colonial revolts and actually labor strikes against British rule. The fighting in Athens produced a scandal amongst the British public. Keep in mind, World War II was still going on. British troops were fighting in the Battle of the Bulge. Now here were these same troops engaged in open warfare with the anti-fascist resistance in Greece. Churchill was denounced in Parliament by members of the Labor Party and even by some fellow Tories. He actually flew to Greece on Christmas Day of 1944 to negotiate an end to the fighting. Initially, the negotiations fell apart, but Elas still would not seize the opportunity. And another offensive by the British drove Elas out of the city of Athens in January. And the communists had lost a battle which had devastated Athens and left tens of thousands dead. And this military defeat was compounded by a political one. When on January 11, 1945, Elas asked for an armistice and talks were reopened with the British. A month later, all Greek parties, with the support of the Allies, signed the Treaty of Akarsia, and the treaty had called for the demobilization of Elas and other guerrilla groups and amnesty for political offenses. But in actuality, many of the actions of partisans were still classified as criminal acts. Legalization of the Communist Party, a referendum to decide the fate of the monarchy, and general elections for a new government. The treaty had compounded the defeat of the Communist Party in December and was an unmitigated disaster at every single level. Arius refused to accept defeat after the uprising, since most of Ellis remained intact. He was prepared to go against the committee, the Central Committee, to resume the armed struggle, and the Communist Party did everything possible to disrupt him, his efforts to reach out to other capitanos to reorganize the resistance. When Zacharias returned from Dachau in April of 1945, he resumed his position as General Secretary and supported the treaty. He would not tolerate a breach of discipline by Arias, and in June he denounced him, actually. Arias was never able to answer his detractor since he was busy organizing a new guerrilla army and killed in battle. And on June 16, 1945, in the mountains, he was ambushed by forces of the enemy and his head was severed and displayed as a trophy and a warning. And despite the denunciation of Arias, within a year the Communist Party would be forced to take up arms again. And ultimately the martyr Arias was proven right, but alas, it was too late for him. And in regards to assessing the errors of the Communist Party in 1944 to take power, there's actually a great deal of convergence of the reasons on the far left for their failure. So on the one hand, we have the Trotskyist historian Pierre Bruet, who not only faults Soviet advice in politics, but criticizes their line of renouncing a class approach that left them politically disarmed. And the Maoist Kostas Mavrakis criticizes the opportunism of the KKE. And anarchists such as Andrew Flood laid blame square on the party's subordination to Moscow. And lastly, interestingly enough, the Communist Party itself, in a statement released on their 90th anniversary, states that they lost a major opportunity to take power through lack of strategy by subjecting themselves to British command and underestimating the class content of the resistance. It's a very long statement, which I won't read. Now, there's, again, general consensus that the Communist Party had subordinated the class struggle to the national one, lacked a clear revolutionary strategy, and was outmaneuvered by the British. And some will, of course, put more emphasis on the connection with Moscow as well. Now, for the next year, despite the formal promise of the treaty that all forces were to be disarmed, members of the Communist Party and LS were repeatedly subjected to attacks from right-wing paramilitaries who operated with impunity. More than 1,000 pro-communists were murdered by these death squads. At the same time, following the uprising, the government had released all members of the security battalions, and now 12,000 of them were serving in the National Guard. And the party was, of course, in an untenable position. On the one hand, its supporters were being killed with the tacit support of the government, while on the other, they remained committed to legality. Nor had amnesty spared members of LS from criminal prosecution. From 1945 to 46, close to 50,000 with connections to LS were imprisoned. To escape retribution, at least 5,000 members moved into exile in Bulgaria, Yugoslavia, and Albania, which were then people's democracies. So, as a result, many members of LS formed their own self-defense units without sanction from the Communist Party to protect themselves from white terror. And liberation did not improve the lot of the average Greek either. There were 1 million refugees, nearly 900,000 who suffered from disease, along with, of course, the hundreds of thousands killed. The Greek currency lost its value, the cost of living skyrocketed, and many members of LS could be forgiven if they asked why they had fought and what their comrades had died for during the war. And by 1946, the situation deteriorated. The Greeks in exile and the people's democracies were secretly returning home, linking up with the self-defense units, and attacking the right-wing forces. Still, the communists remained more interested in the upcoming elections in March, but even they could not ignore the violence and decided to boycott the elections. And the international situation was changed as the wartime alliance broke down and was replaced by the Cold War. Aid for the KKE was now particularly forthcoming from neighboring countries, particularly Yugoslavia. And growing more confident, the Communist Party began openly denounced responsible for the British for escalating violence, and the party had already begun sending cadre to the provinces at the end of 1945 to organize resistance. However, the leadership of the Communist Party, especially Zacharias, clung to the old models and put all his efforts into the cities. And he did not want, again, an rural guerrilla movement. And these policies of him, who feared the popular movement of the people, would ultimately ensure defeat for the Communist Party. In March of 1946, the boycott elections were won by the right wing, who organized a plebiscite to restore the monarchy later that year. The lines were drawn, and at the end of that month, a band of LS troops attacked a small town near Mount Olympus, beginning civil war. Yes, it took that long to get there. In response, the government quickly restored the organs of repression left over from the dictatorship, imprisoned again thousands of LS supporters, and by the end of 1947, the Communist Party formed a provisional democratic government, and all leftist parties were officially banned in Greece. The KKE now had a new insurgent force known as the Democratic Army, or the DSE, in October of 1946. It was under the command of Marcos Zavikis, a veteran of LS. They possessed approximately 7,000 soldiers in November, growing to 13,000 in March of 1947, and reaching 35,000 by the end of that summer. And at least 20% were women, and the vast majority were very young. And their strategy was to operate from safe space bases in Albania, Yugoslavia, and Bulgaria, engage the Greek army. And they had a high-level support in Macedonia, which gave those plans some credits. And they foresaw a protracted struggle before the Communist Party could defeat the crown. And initially, the government seemed vulnerable. The Greek army barely existed in 1946 and was hastily deployed when the Civil War began, although by the end of the war, they reached 132,000. In the beginning, at least, a great deal of conscript deserted from the government and went over to the other side. Yet the government was fast losing ground and unable to quell the insurgents. And on February 20th, 1947, Britain, who had been financing the Greek government, announced they could no longer afford to do so. And the Second World War had devastated and bankrupted Britain, and its empire was slipping away. Without British support, there was a real possibility of Greece succumbing to the Democratic Army. Yet the United States was not going to allow Greece, the cradle of Western civilization, to fall to the forces of godless communism. And on March 12th of 1947, President Harry S. Truman, a Democrat, spoke before a joint session of Congress outlining what would become known as the Truman Doctrine, pledging that the United States would contain communism and support the Greek government. Behind all the noble-sounding rhetoric of freedom and democracy, Truman had now committed the United States to support an authoritarian monarchist government that was propped up by an army of Nazi collaborators in order to fight the wartime communist resistance. And U.S. military assistance poured into Greece in that summer, and the scale of that aid was immense. Effectively, Greece became an offshore U.S. base. The U.S. had taken control of the planning and training of the Greek army. They removed sections of the population to deprive the communists of basis of support, a foretaste of the strategic hamlets that would become known in Vietnam, and all U.S. military and economic and political aid to Greece threatened to overwhelm the Democratic Army. Yet, despite this, the DSE was still able to score a number of victories. But Sicardius was not willing to fight a long war and wanted swift victory. So in September of 1947, he shifted from guerrilla warfare to regular warfare to launch a victorious offensive against the regime seemed to be on the verge of collapse. After years of serving as a brake on revolutionary initiative by the party, now the general secretary himself was pushing for an offensive. Yet he was not Ares. His directive went against all logic, military and political. He never valued guerrilla warfare and wanted to launch an offensive against cities, such as Athens. No doubt, his shift in strategy was motivated with the hope of gaining control over the war effort and to limit the power of the Capitanos. The DSE commander was out enraged at this and favored guerrilla warfare, but he's unable to get the army to change course. The disagreements between the two over military line led to a dismissal of leadership of Marcos from the DSE in 1948. By now, Sicardius was in sole command of the DSE, and the turn to regular warfare being conditioned by the communists forming a government and the KKE to hold ground to gain foreign recognition, which they never got. At first, Sicardius' strategy coincided with the KKE gaining momentum and achieving victories, and in summer of 1948, 12,000 DSE troops managed to hold off 50,000 government troops for 2 months, and the DSE units across Greece remained formidable, bogging down the enemies. Yet these battles coincided with the split between Tito and Stalin. The split proved disastrous for the Communist Party. Tito had been one of the major backers of the DSE strategy of guerrilla warfare. Sicardius not only pursued a more orthodox military line, but he backed Stalin and condemned Tito. The split caused Yugoslavia to close their borders to the Greek communists, depriving them of a rear base area. Without support from Yugoslavia, DSE forces in Macedonia and Thrace were isolated. By now, the Greek government, aided by the United States, launched several new offensives, overrunning the communists in the south and the north. The Greek army had the initiative and managed to wipe out various communist forces throughout 1948 and 49. the tide had decisively turned. On October 16th, the Democratic Army formally ceased operations in a broadcast announced by Radio Free Greece. And despite the boast, which they said they would continue to resist, the war was over, and the DSC was totally and utterly defeated. At least 158,000 Greeks had died during the Civil War. Between 50,000 and 100,000 LS fighters were now in exile in people's democracies. Thousands of communists and sympathizers wasted away in prisons. The counter-revolution reigned triumphant in Greece. The KKK had been defeated by a combination of their poor military and political line, the split in the socialist camp, and the better-trained and led Greek troops, who were bolstered by USA. For the Greek left, defeat was not only the beginning of a long and horrendous ordeal. Greece remained under right-wing rule for decades. Greek society to this day remains polarized by the legacy of the Civil War. Only in the 1970s would the Communist Party actually be legalized and the Greek monarchy abolished after the US-backed regime of the colonels. While the sacrifices of LS are finally recognized and honored by the current left-leaning Syriza government, the socialist dream of the partisans who followed Aris to the mountains has yet to be realized. Questions, comments, concerns, polemics, whatever. Feel free.
Just one comment.
Sure.
Thanks.
Thanks
for all of your work, but I have to tell you, this has to be one of the most depressing.
I thought the Spanish Civil War one was more depressing.
I think.
Unfortunately, it was long, but I'm also like, how much background do you people know? So I have to assume not as much. But so there's a lot of details, and of course you can see links to current events. But again, I'll let other people talk. Feel free to respond to each other. I've been talking for an hour. Anyone? Sure, John.
The Greek Civil War and the events leading to it were such a long, complicated process that I never bothered to study it much, I'll confess. So I found your talk very illuminating. I think the general lines of what was going on I've understood over the years, but in no such detail at all, quite frankly. But I really appreciate you outlining how this whole process unfolded. That, you know, there were actually two civil wars in a sense. You know, sort of the dress rehearsal, and then the real thing, which was doomed to failure due to leadership. That's the way I see it. You know, the death of the central leader of ALOS, Aries, was a big blow. It's, you know, reminds me of when Sandino was assassinated in Nicaragua, which decapitated the popular movement there. And ushered in the dynasty of the Somoza regimes for decades after that under a military-type dictatorship, of fascists, quite frankly.
Just for the record, I promise, pretty much, I've actually finished all the other talks of the year. None of them are actually this long. But before I take any more questions, CMA is thankfully not sponsored by any corporation. So if you want to get on either our email list or donate a few bucks to help, that would be most welcome. But we'll continue with questions, comments, concerns.
I wanted to add to everyone here who doesn't know the movie The Traveling Players. I don't know if that came into your research, but
no.
It's a terrific movie about basically the history that you've laid out. It's actually Frederick Jameson's favorite film, apparently, a little gossip, but in Greek, I think it's Othasos, but Traveling Players. It's an amazing film. It's 10 times as long as your talk, but
wow.
It truly is something to watch with the group, and maybe in the future I could propose to organize something around that, but
sure.
it's an incredible movie that was a Brechtian film, kind of a play within a play, which precisely illuminates what we're talking about. There's this, it's almost like a Prussian egg. There are all these struggles within struggles within struggles. So, which is not unique to Greece, but certainly like a, you know, what's the character of this person?
If you give me your email,
yeah,
I'll connect you with Richard Pendleton, who handles the film Z.
Great, great, I'll do that now.
Again, reminder, if you want to see the film Z, that's tomorrow at 6.
Yeah.
Which is a terrific film.
That's a terrific film.
I'll be here showing it, so.
I remember. What?
Sign up sheet.
I did. Oh, I didn't get to you because he was
sick,
so I won't come back sitting. Years ago, maybe, I don't know. Oh my God, it must be 40 years ago at least. I heard Costa Gargas at Yale speaking.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I mean, it was incredible. The character he played, he literally wound up having the same nightmares as that characters at. Yeah.
Anyone else got stuff to say? I've probably covered a lot, but I'm certain there's plenty I didn't cover. I didn't like. I don't know this area quite as well as this, you know, something like Blanky, but
I mean, it just seems to me. Oh God, I mean, right pretty early on, where they were concerned about developing the national struggle. I mean, the national struggle, the struggle for socialism, really intersect, but the national struggle is very limited.
Yeah.
And so you really, you know, if you have your communist leadership, it's really your obligation to have a program then to see how we actually get our needs fulfilled. And having that program can move people forward, and instead.
Yeah, I mean, obviously national liberation to a conquered people is important, but I think Frantz Fanon actually, who's involved in the Algerian War of Independence, said nationalism is not a political program. In his Wretch of the Earth, he said, unless you move over to social liberation, I'm paraphrasing, you know, you're going to be empty. You're not going to go as far. And a Marxist like James Connolly, who I spoke on last year, explicitly linked the two. He didn't privilege one or the other in, you know, the case of Ireland. And of course, ultimately, the people who came after privileged the national struggle and neglected the social struggle, and therefore compromised the national struggle as well. But yeah, and obviously figures like Tito and Mao, whatever else one can say about them, I do not want to get into a long debate on them, were willing to translate those aspirations into a bid for power. And, you know, I would consider the regimes of both to be immensely superior to what came before, whatever other criticisms one can lay at them. But in Greece, no such liberation occurred. Anything else?
I'm just kind of curious what everybody's background is here. You all know each other from prior talks.
A lot of people.
Some of us worked together here at the CME. Well, three of us here are on the steering committee.
Yeah.
And some of us have been to other talks here. And Doug does this monthly, the first Saturday of the month. So.
Before John, does anyone else have a? No? John?
I'm a member of the Communist Party, and I know our local chapter here in Boston seriously seeks to study these lessons from history and not return to these catastrophic mistakes that were made in places like Greece and in Spain, other places where at times communist parties have engaged in militarily acting against the forces of revolution. Or betraying. I think that all communists need to look at these lessons from history and learn from them and pursue a programmatic course that steers the movement away from this kind of what I would call class collaborations. And even among those that were victors, like, and, you know, I'll comment a little.
No, go ahead.
In China, for instance, and China and other places, as these societies evolved, the leaders like Mao Zedong became, well, I'll just pick on him for a minute, you know, he became a direct ally of the United States in its external policy. Closed its embassy in Chile when the fascist leadership took over there and were slaughtering people. They closed their embassy to the people who were fleeing the slaughter. At the time I was around, I remember hearing supporters of China saying the biggest danger to the continent was Soviet social imperialism. And they were aligned with the United States. So there's a general debate issue, which I will say centers around the issue of what I call class collaborationism, you know, kind of collaborating with the enemy and selling the workers out, essentially. So, you know, in the future, communists need to avoid and provide an alternative different from that.
My grandfather was a communist in Greece, and he was executed in 1952 with Nikos Belenyanis, and so my mother was illegally adopted to this country, as was has a whole history about children of communists who were trafficked to America and Britain. She was one of those people. So, you know, my grandfather was executed for organizing a illegal radio station in his basement. So he was one of many. This is forget about the personal story. It's just this is a national story, an international story. So that's my biological entrance that is not only edible, but is, of course, political as well. But he was killed post this story for picking up the, you know, picking up what others had dropped. And so I really appreciate your comments about, you know, researching this history in order to, you know, educate yourself for the future.
I actually didn't consult.
The Civil War is much better known on the left than the people. The Greek Civil War is also of importance.
Yeah, I
one
mean.
One thing, it did a lot to shape. It was a Cold War.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting to note, like, when the Greek Civil War, at least, or if you want, the second phase of it, is occurring, like, communists are actually still in the national governments in France, in Italy, where like these were parties of millions of people.
They've always been socialists.
Yeah, and you know, throughout Western Europe as well. And at the same time, of course, Mao's struggle was still going on in China. The Philippines, Malaysia, Vietnam were all fighting under, had in struggles under communist leadership. And even the CPUSA was much, much stronger at that point. Whatever else one can say about it. But, you know, that's like part of the global context. And of course, these colonial empires are collapsing. Like within 15 years, the British Empire formally will like lose most of its possessions. And it's just interesting to look at that. Anything else? All right, I'm gonna adjourn this then, unless someone has something else to say.
Thank you so much.
All right. Come to the movie tomorrow, come to next month's talk.